Oh Lord, you brought us from a mighty long way, mighty long stay in the wilderness. Oh Lord, you brought us through the thick and thin, through the fire and wind, to a better place. You brought us out to bring us in. Oh Lord, you brought us from a mighty long way, mighty long stay in the wilderness. Oh Lord, you brought us through the thick and thin, through the fire and wind, to a better place. Brought us out to bring us in. All those years longing for a land we would start, but too weak to stand, then they took their toll, tyrants of their soul. With no place we could call our own, with no song, Lord, you heard our groan, and you made a way where there was no way. Oh Lord, you brought us from a mighty long way, mighty long stay in the wilderness. Out of chain and the bonds of men, out of death and the curse of sin, through the desert sand to the promised land. Oh Lord, you brought us from a mighty long way, mighty long stay in the wilderness.
Ourselves into. Everybody goes through something, and people may look at us and wonder, what's he going through? I think of that when you drive all through the streets of Albuquerque and you see a homeless person on the side of the road, and some of them have a stare in their eyes. They're just looking out. And some of them seem to know what they're doing. Like that's a lot easier than going to work. And I come to to my conclusions like we all do. But then I pray. I say, Lord, I don't know what they're going through. What might they be going through? Only by the grace of God, and I'll speak for myself, that could be any one of us. So whatever we think, however we feel, just pray for him and pray for ourselves. You know, we think, we've read in the Bible and we've heard teachings that the roads are going to be paved in gold and we got mansions and wow, it's really going to be something. Is that really what we need? Is that really what we want? Yeah, we'd like to have that if we're honest with ourselves. Well, to God be the glory if that's what we get, amen. But as long as we're there, even just to see it, even if we're there just to see it, maybe I won't have the mansion. Maybe I will. God's will be done, huh? On those things. I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more but walk the streets that are pure as gold. Don't think me poor or deserted or lonely. I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow. Someday yonder we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold. But walk the streets that are pure as gold. Walk the streets of purest gold. Just not to be old, my goodness. And it's funny that we look at old as being a bad thing. My beautiful wife will tell our granddaughters, gee, I told you, don't get old, don't get old. And I think about that. I said, well, getting old is okay. You know, for years, because in the business I was in, I used to do my hair. Here I'm confessing that in front of the world, but like nobody knew, right? And my step this was quite a few years ago, 10, 15 years ago, and he said, "Do you do your hair?" And I said, "Yeah, I Judy, my wife tells me." I said, "Okay." And he said, "That's okay, because you're in the business." To this day now, I think he was giving me the business, you know that? But I've heard guys say, growing old's not for sissies. Right, Brother Greg? But we were so involved in our youth that someday we'd get old and feeble. It's not a bad thing. My dad lived to be 94. I see Brother Jake over here. My goodness. They don't stop. We can't stop. No matter what we're going through, as I said earlier, everybody's going through something. And it seems unbearable. It seems so hard. But in His time, God's going to make everything. Everything. In His time, in His time, He makes all things beautiful. In His time, Lord, please show me as You're teaching me Your way, that You do just what You say in Your time. In Your time. In Your time. You make all. In Your time, Lord, my life to You I bring. May each song I have to sing be to You a lovely thing. In Your time, this is all I have to bring to You, Lord. Song. I pray it's a lovely thing, but it'll be in Your time, Lord. In Your time, in Your time, You make all things beautiful. In Your time, Lord, my life to You I bring. May each song I have to sing to You a lovely thing in Your time. Be to You a lovely thing in Your time.
Would you stand with me as we pray? Does God know what we're going through? Yes. When nobody else does. Peter says, when we're overwhelmed with a burden, we can cast our care upon Him, upon Jesus, for he careth for you. He cares for us. He cares about us. The idea is that we can roll our burdens on Jesus just like rolling a burden on a beast of burden, on a donkey, in that imagery of 2,000 years ago. We can cast our burdens on the Lord because he cares. When nobody else understands, when nobody else cares, when nobody else... He does, huh? He does. Whatever you're going through right now, let's bring it to the Lord, shall we? Lord, we know that all things are working together for good. We know that somehow you're bringing the hurt in our heart. You're bringing the burdens of this body. Somehow, Lord, you're bringing together all of the good stuff and especially all of the hard stuff. You're bringing it to bear to make us more and more like you. We don't understand it. We don't get it. Often we don't like it. But we believe you. But Lord, my prayer now is that in this hurt, while we're under this burden, God, that we would find great relief, great joy in knowing that it's okay to roll that burden onto you because you care for our souls. And I do pray that you would lift those burdens, somehow show enough relief that we can see you through the pain, that we can see you through the hurt, that we can see you through the suffering that you are using to bring us closer to you. I don't get it. I often don't like it. But we believe you, Jesus, that you're working all things together for good to those who love you, to those who are the called according to your purpose. Thank you for forgiving us. Thank you for saving us. And thank you for changing us. And Lord, we can't wait to see how you're going to use us next. Through all of this, you're going to use us. We praise you. We can't wait to see what you're going to do next. We bring all of these things to you in your name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Please be seated. What is God doing in his time? Paul was a prisoner in a dungeon. There, not because he'd done anything wrong, but because he had done everything right, because he was trying to live for the Lord. He had taken his life and he set it aside for God. And in all of that, he found himself in a prison under Roman guard, in trouble, maybe about to lose his life. He had certainly lost his freedom because of his faith in Christ, because of his position in Christ. And he wrote to the church at Philippi while he was in this dungeon, in this prison. He shackled to a Roman guard, probably one on either side. And he penned these words, and to that church at Philippi, he said in chapter 1, verse about 21, he said, you know, a lot of these guys are preaching Christ. They think they're poking me. They think they're really getting to me. These preachers, a lot of these guys, there's a lot of envy. There's a lot of ambition, foolish ambition. And they think they're getting to me by going out and preaching harder, preaching stronger. Look at Paul. He ain't all that. But Christ is being preached, he said. And he said, you know what? I get into these situations where I think, you know, I've given my heart to Jesus, and I trust him, and I know him, and these burdens are so overwhelming. I can't wait to go home. I can't wait to go home. The pain will be gone. The pressure will be gone. I can't wait to go home. But then he says, but I'm in a strait betwixt, the King James says. I'm caught between two worlds because I want to go home where the hurt is gone, where the confusion is gone. But as long as I'm here, Christ can still use me to bless people. Christ can still use me to bring people to him. So I'm kind of caught between the two. So he says in Philippians 1:21, to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Philippians 1:21. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. He wanted to die. He wanted to go home. It was gain. James Merritt said this morning that Adrian Rogers said, heads I win, tails I win. If I win, I win. If I lose, I win. If I stay alive, I win. If I die, I win. Because I leave this place and I go to be with Christ. Philippians 1:21. For to me, to live, I want to live the rest of my days. This is what we're going to be talking about again this morning. You think I'm just beating on you all the time? I am, but I want you to be able to stand before the Lord. I want you to be able to go before the Lord with anticipation, with a joy, with a relief that comes from knowing that with all the mess ups that you might have ever made, of course you haven't, but some have, with all the mess ups that we've made, all of that is behind us. From here, I reach forward for the prize, Paul said. With the last of my days, with the last of my weeks, with the last of my months, maybe years. For to me, to live is to live it for Christ. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Philippians 1:21. For to me. Would you say that with me? For to me. For to me, to live is Christ. To live is Christ. One more time. To live is Christ. And to die is gain. All together if you can. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. That's the reason that I'm talking about this morning. Satan is dangerous. And he does want to mess you up. He doesn't know you personally. You've never had to go hand to hand with the real Satan. There's one Satan. He's real. He's rebellious. But he does his work in bigger ways. Satan controls government. Government allows culture. Culture messes us up. Culture makes it okay for us to not live for Jesus. Satan makes it okay for unbelievers to not come to Jesus. Satan is dangerous for the sinner. Satan tries to hinder salvation. 1 John 5:19. The whole world is under the control of the evil one. Who's under the control of the evil one? The whole world. That's everybody you know. That's everybody beside you at the red light. That's everybody in your family. That's everybody next door. That's everybody at work. That's everybody at school. That's everybody except those who have come to Christ. This is everybody. The whole world is under the control of the evil one. 2 Corinthians 4:4. The God of this age, who's the God of this age? Satan. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the glorious light of the gospel. Now, if you love anything, again, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain, Paul said. And that's the attitude that he wants us to have. If I live, praise the Lord, I can live the rest of my days for God. If I die, praise the Lord, I go to be with God. So it's in that spirit that I'm telling you what I find in the scripture. If you love anything in this life more than you love the Lord, anything, anybody, if you love anything in this life more than you love the Lord, does this sound like me? You're probably not saved. Yeah, it's just an indicator. Yeah? Lauren flies. Lauren's a pilot on top of everything else that she does. Federal regulations say that your fuel, it only has to be accurate when it's empty. All the rest of the time, you need to make sure that you're on top of it and you're figuring things out. I want your gauge to be accurate. I want your indicators for life to be right on. I want when you were looking at, how am I doing? When you're deciding, hey, how was my day? When you're thinking about, hey, how do I feel? I want your indicator to not be based on the way the world says, what's success? What's okay? How do you feel? I want your indicators, I want your gauge to be set on what he has to say. And he says, anything in this life more than you love the Lord, you're probably not saved. That's pretty harsh, but listen to what he says. Matthew 10:37. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Is he saying hate your father? No. hate your mother? No, he says honor your father and honor your mother. But Jesus, who said honor your father and your mother, said anyone who loves father or mother, what? More than me, more than Jesus, is not worthy to be my disciple. 37, anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Is he saying don't love your son or daughter? No, he's not saying that. He says don't love your son or daughter more than you love me. 38, whoever loves their own life and does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Is he saying hate your life? Well, kind of. But in another place, he says, if you don't love yourself, if you don't love your life, you're going to have a difficult time ministering. He's not saying hate your life, hate your family, hate your parents. He's not saying that. He's saying that if you love anything in this world more than you love the Lord, you're probably not a disciple. You're probably not a follower, is what he's saying. 39, whoever finds their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Matthew 22:37. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. That's a lot. That's a lot of me. All my heart, all my soul, all my mind, all my strength, with everything that's in me, I'm supposed to love the Lord. With everything that's in me, I'm supposed to love my wife. No, with everything in me, I love my wife. You don't have to make me. You don't have to threaten me. All she has to do is give me that look. And that's scary enough. But she doesn't threaten me to love her. I love her. She's over there with the kids, so she can't hear me. I can say whatever I want. We've been married almost 25 years. November, Kennedy was assassinated the 22nd, so the 23rd, that's how I remember tragedy, and then it got worse from there. The day. Almost 25 years we've been married. And I'm telling you, I love her as much or more today as I did then. I am still in awe of her. What husband is in awe of their wife? I mean, maybe you guys, but you know, ordinary mortals. What husband still admires his wife? I know you guys. It's like Donald and Melania. He's hugging her. She's going like, get off of me. What husband still is in awe? Admires. Again, I know you guys honestly are, most of you guys are the exception, but in the real world, I feel sorry for most husbands and wives, don't you? I do. When you think about what they have to go home to, I didn't mean to look at you. Yeah, I was just, I'm sorry. I'm going to get you. You know what I mean? It's hard. Married life at best is hard. And I'm happy. I'm telling you, it's hard. And he says, if I don't love him more than I love my wife, I'm not worthy to be a disciple. If I love my kids more than I love the Lord, I'm not worthy to be his disciple. If I love my mom or dad more than I love him, I'm not worthy to be a disciple. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. It's written like a command, but who has to tell you to love somebody that you love? You know what I mean? You fall in love with somebody, they can't shut you up. You talk about them. You want to be with them. You know what? Again, she's not in here. I can say whatever I want. Have you ever seen her around me? She doesn't leave me alone. She's always wanting to touch me and hang on me and hook a leg on me and bring me things. Yeah, I hate it. Yeah, I hate it. Said, vieja, get away from me. It's crazy, huh? It's crazy. I like it. I like it. When you love somebody, you just want to talk about them. You just want to be with them. You know, you're not always, you know. I'm sure I haven't always been perfect. It's one thing to tolerate. It's quite another thing to just want to be there all the time. That's what he's talking about. Satan doesn't want you to be there. Satan doesn't, again, he doesn't know who you are. Satan doesn't bother you. There are demons, but you don't even need demons. Satan doesn't seduce us. Those of us who've given our lives to Jesus, he doesn't seduce us to be wicked. He seduces us to be worldly and worthless. And that means don't love the Lord with all your heart. Love something else more. Well, for the sinner, that's going to make it hard to get saved because I love me too much. So if you love anything in this life more than you love the Lord, you're probably not saved. So for the sinner, again, that's what God calls the unbeliever. That's what God calls the one who says, you know what? I know more. I don't need all this. On Wednesday nights, we're talking through the book of Proverbs. We're talking about the simple. The simple is the open-minded, and the simple can become smart and then go to spiritual. Simple, smart, spiritual. That's what the Proverbs were written for. That's what the whole Bible's written for. But the Proverbs specifically were to take the open-minded, the childish, you know, the kid who doesn't know anything, and to make him smart, and then to make him spiritual. You can go in a good direction, or you can go in a bad direction. And the bad direction, I didn't mean to make, you know, good and bad of this church like that. So we'll say good and bad. Right away, they were starting to squirm over here. By the way, you know, that's the center row. They all sit together over there. You can go from simple to smart to spiritual, or you can go from simple to, you guys remember, scornful and then stupidful. The simple, they don't know anything. That's what the Bible says, and the simple, they don't know, and that's okay. You know, they're kind of saffy-daffy. They're kind of cute. You know, no, he doesn't know anything. The simple don't know anything. The scornful, they think they know everything. The Bible calls that person the mocker. They mock. They make fun because they know more than everybody. Simple, they don't know anything. The scornful, they think they know everything. The stupidful, they think they know more than God. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That's the sinner. That's the unbeliever. That's the person who's decided, you know what? I don't need this stuff. That's archaic. Men wrote this. You know, this is, that's for you religious people. Well, to the unbeliever, the Bible says Satan has blinded them and they can't see the glorious light of the gospel. To those of us who don't have any better sense but to believe, he doesn't call us a sinner anymore, although we still sin. He calls us saints. Get cute, no? If you grew up Catholic, that's a pretty big thing, except in the Bible, it's not that big a deal. I mean, it's a big deal, but you don't have to be canonized. You don't go through the church. For the sinner who thinks he knows more than God, Satan tries to hinder salvation. Where am I now? For the saint? Yep. Satan tries to hinder service. That's what you do after you get saved. It's not what you do to get saved. It's what you do after you get saved. After you give your life to Jesus, now you become more like Jesus. After you come to Christ, now you live the rest of your life for Christ. He calls that service. Mark 10:45. For even the Son of Man, who's that? Jesus. Even the Son of Man didn't come to be served, but rather he came to serve, to give his life as a ransom for many. 1 Peter 4:10. Each one should use whatever gift he has to serve others. Faithfully administer God's grace in its various forms. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. Romans 12:11. Never be lacking in zeal. Stay excited, stay up. But not for you, for him, he says. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor always what? Serving the Lord. Saints are supposed to serve. That's what we do. That's what we're supposed to do. Saints, people who've come to Christ are supposed to become more like Christ. People who've come to Jesus are supposed to live for Jesus. People who know the Lord are supposed to live for the Lord. That means serving. That's what that means. For the saint, Satan tries to hinder service. He works to seduce you so that you won't serve God. So that you won't serve God. There, I don't think there's anybody here, and I, you know, I'm kind of rough on all of you, James, but all of you... I don't think there's anybody here who doesn't think they're not serving the Lord. I mean, we're giving it a shot. We're not all crazy like you, Tony. But, you know, we're serving the Lord. We're serving the Lord. I want to help your indicator. I want to help your gauge. I want to help your gas gauge. I want it to be accurate, not just when it's empty. I want you to be able to look at your indicators and be able to tell, not from what the world tells you, not from what your mama told you, not from what grandma told you, worse, not from what some preacher told you. I want you to know what God has to say about things so that when you are looking at your life and you're asking the question, how am I doing? You can answer the question from God's point of view, not just from your point of view. Satan is not trying to make you wicked, saint. You've given your life to the Lord. He's not trying to make you sin. You don't need any help there, I told you last week. And that surprised you, right? Like that. Satan is not seducing you to be wicked. Satan is tricking you, seducing you through culture to make it so that you'll be worldly. The end result is so that you won't serve him. James 4:4. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God. Now, first of all, the world is not talking about the planet, globe or flat earth, it doesn't matter. He's not talking about the tierra. He's talking about the gente. Yeah. He's not talking about the dirt. He's talking about the people that live on the planet. The world that he's talking about is not the planet. The world that he's talking about is not the people. The world that he's talking about is the government that's controlled by Satan that creates culture. That. Everything that you live under, it doesn't matter if you're in North Korea, doesn't matter if you're in America, doesn't matter if you're in the southern states, doesn't matter if you live up north, doesn't matter if you're in Canada, Cuba, it doesn't matter. Every culture controls. It does. Every culture controls. That's what tells you what's cool. Some of you grew up in a culture where tattoos were cool. You probably got a tattoo. Some of you, some of it, you back there in the back, out. Some of you guys grew up in a culture where tattoos weren't cool. You probably didn't get one, or if you did, you felt guilty about it. Some of you grew up in a culture where everybody smoked. You probably smoked. You grew up in a culture where nobody smoked. You probably didn't smoke. Grew up in a culture where drinking was, ooh, so you don't drink. Grew up in a culture where nobody drank, you don't drink. Culture tells you what's cool, and nobody wants to not be cool. I don't mean, hey, Fonzie cool. I mean, you don't want to feel like the outsider. You don't want to feel like the weird one. Somehow everybody wants to feel like they're okay. And I'm telling you, Satan controls governments, it controls culture, and culture tells you what's okay. Culture tells you whether it's okay to be a thug or not. Culture tells you whether it's okay to be a Baptist or not. Culture tells you whether it's okay to wear shorts in the winter or not. I know, I feel all overdressed. I feel like I'm wearing a tuxedo or something. Culture tells you, Safa, what are you doing wearing shorts in the winter? You know? But in my culture, in my head, that's cool. Yeah, I'll be wearing a big old parka, but I'll be wearing shorts. Yeah. Culture tells you what's okay and what's not okay. That's not a good indicator. That indicator, I set the indicator. You can't reset odometers anymore, can you? The mileage on your cars. Back in the olden days, car salesmen used to, they would never set them back just because they could. You know, put it up on jacks and run the car in reverse. Watch those numbers go backwards. I saw him do that in a Roy Rogers episode. I don't know if you can really do that or not. If you can reset your odometer, if you can reset your gauges, I'm telling you that indicator's wrong. If the world is telling you what's okay, if your family is telling you what's okay, if the way you did it at home is telling you what's okay, if the way your preacher, your mama, your grandpa, whoever told you that's okay, that's not a good indicator. The indicator is God's word. The world that he's talking about is the culture that you live in, okay? You adulterous people, he's not talking about sexual adultery here, he's talking about spiritual adultery, but it's just as bad. You leave your love. And your love here is supposed to be the Lord. That means you're serving other gods. Who here would say we're serving other gods? None of us would say we're serving other gods. But he says you're serving other gods if you're friends with the world. If you like what the world likes, if you think it's cool to be like everybody on your block, you're fighting against God. That's what enmity means. Look at the rest of verse 4. Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes a what? An enemy of God. None of us would say we are an enemy of God. He's not talking to sinners. He's talking to saints. He's talking to believers. None of us would want to be fighting God. Guys, you want to bring these voter guides? The next verse, Titus 2:11. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly possessions or worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. This present age is represented by culture. These guys, everybody, take one of these now. It's okay because it's not to help you vote. It's to make a point. So everybody, take one of these. I don't care if you vote or not, sinner. I don't care if you vote right or wrong, Democrat. You're so bad. 1 John 2:15. For everything in this world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but rather comes from the world. Where are we? I think, go ahead a little bit. And then one more to 1 John, the Message, NIV. That one. Stay there. Thank you. Okay. You see the guy? Go to the Spanish side. No, I'm just kidding. Go to the English side. You see all these guys on the top? They're Democrats or they're Republicans, okay? I tend to vote Republican. I'm a registered Republican, but that's beside the point. I tend to vote Republican for two reasons. I'm lazy. I used to be able to hit one button and... Is that the other place? You can't do it anymore. So I don't do that in the voting booth. I did it at the other place. See, you're so spiritual. You didn't even get it.
I did get it.
You're still, yeah. I tend to vote all Republican because I'm a little bit lazy, and because I told the Wednesday night guys, I went back Wednesday afternoon so that I would be up to speed, and I looked at the national and the New Mexico platform for Democrats. What do Democrats believe? What is the Democrat agenda? What is the Republican agenda? If everybody was Democrat or everybody was Republican and they could have their way on anything, what laws would they try to pass? So I went to the National Republican, the National Democrat, and the New Mexico Republican and the New Mexico Democrat, all right? I used to tell people, vote for the guy, not that looks most like Santa Claus, meaning, I don't mean that looks like me, but I mean the one that's going to give you the most goodies, because that's the way most people vote. Vote for the one that's going to take care of New Mexico. Vote for the one that's going to bring those Washington dollars to the South Valley. Puke. You know where that money came from? Not from Washington. It came out of my pocket. All these guys have put their faces up on these construction projects in the South Valley. Ticks me off. Have their big old matanzas. You know who pays for that? Me. I don't vote for them. Where was I? Oh, yeah. So all these Republicans and Democrats across the top, again, vote however you want to vote. I'm telling you that to be a friend of the world means you're fighting God. I don't know these guys. I only know what they tell me. I only know when they tell me who they are, that's all I know about them. I don't stalk them on Facebook like I do you. I don't know. I don't know that. Don't get scared. That's what some of you guys won't friend me. I know. I don't know these people. I only know what they tell me. I don't know Nancy Pelosi. I don't know Chuck Schumer. I don't know those guys personally. I only know what they tell me they believe. I only know what Trump says. Actually, I can go back 40 years on his life. I know a lot. I know more about Trump than I know about most people because I was curious and I studied. And you listen to these guys. I don't want to be like Trump when I grow up. But the things he's saying now, the same stuff he was saying 40 years ago, the same stuff he told Oprah, the same stuff he was telling all of those guys. And they all loved him. All of the people who were peeing on his star, they loved him in Hollywood. All of the people who hate his guts, they loved him. All the people who say he's racist, you see photographs of them hugging him and loving him and inviting him to speak at their gatherings until he started to run for president as Republican. Let me tell you why. I don't care if you vote Republican or Democrat, sinner. Let me tell you what is important. What does God have to say about what do you think about animal abuse? What do you think about it? Bad? Does anybody here think it's okay to mistreat a dog? To kick it? To cut a leg off just so you can... That's horrible. Why is it that we know that's awful? And if I ask you, is it okay to mistreat a baby? Is child abuse okay? You would say, I think no. Is it okay to harm a baby? Is it okay to break a baby's leg? Is it okay to, you know, I want more drugs, so I'm going to break my baby's leg to take it to the doctor to get drugs for myself. You would say that's kind of messed up, wouldn't you? Animal abuse is bad. Child abuse is bad. Is killing a kid bad? Yes. Is cutting up a baby, dismembering, like butchering a hog, is cutting up a baby bad? Okay. I know. I know our culture says something that I'm about to throw out here is okay. What is abortion? What does the word literally mean? When you abort something, you just stop it, is what it means. You stop a pregnancy. How do you stop a pregnancy? They can inject a saline solution. They can inject a poison. They can go in. I mean, the baby is in the nursery. Make it a little smaller. The baby is in its bassinet. Make it a little smaller. The baby is in its mother's arms. Make it a little smaller. The baby is resting on mama's tummy. Make it a little closer. The baby's inside mama's tummy. When is it okay to go in there and abuse the kid? When is it okay to make the baby hurt? When is it okay to cut the baby up in pieces? When is it okay to smash a baby's head? When is it okay to stab a baby with forceps in the back of the neck? When is it okay to take a vacuum and suction out the baby's brain? Or to take the forceps and scramble the baby's brain to kill it? And then to go in, the baby's been delivered now, feet first, the little feet, the little legs, the little behind, the little torso, and the head is still in the mama. And they stab the baby in the back of the neck, kill the baby, crush the head, and then bring the baby out. That's an abortion. That's legal in New Mexico, and it happens every single day. 3,000-4,000 abortions happen every day in the states like that. They go in if the baby's smaller. Oh, the baby doesn't feel anything. They literally cut it up. Well, it's still a mama. It doesn't feel anything. That's abortion. I looked at the national platform for Republicans. I looked at the national platform for Democrats. I mean, your primos, your buddies, the ones you go to the matanzas and like on Facebook, Democrats. Look at every Democrat. What do they say about abortion? Are they for it or against it? Every Democrat is for it. I don't know them. I know what God says about killing. I know what God says about protecting the innocent. I know that if I vote for any Democrat, I'm dangerously close to loving the world and fighting with God. I'm not killing babies. Schumer is not killing babies. Pelosi is not killing babies. Small is not killing babies. Harlan's not killing babies. Grisham's not killing babies. But as long as they're not stopping it with the laws they enact, they're encouraging it. What does Pierce think about killing babies? No. Culture says it's even wrong for me to say killing babies. That's not fair, Tony. That's a loaded term. It's an abortion and it's a woman's right. You're talking about the baby woman? That one? It's the baby's right? No, I'm talking about the woman. It's not her life we're talking about. We're talking about the baby's life. Oh, pobrecita, what have she got into? I'm not saying that's not tragic. I'm not saying that it is horrible. Let's help her. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying don't care. I'm saying once the baby's there, I mean from the time of conception, from the time the baby's there, we're talking about a separate life. Look across the page at your leisure. What do the Democrats think about taking the life of an unborn baby? I can't vote for them. The Republicans, they might be horrible people, I don't know. But what do they have to say about killing babies? On something not as biblical. I mean, does the Bible say I have a right to pack heat? Does the Bible say it's okay for Lauren to be able to kill me 17 different ways with just stuff she carries on her person, and then she can do with her hands and other ways? And does the Bible say you have the right to carry a weapon? I don't see that anywhere. I don't. Well, the Bible says I have the right to carry a gun. Where? Show me a passage of Scripture. Doesn't say don't. This Second Amendment thing, I'm telling you, Wednesday night we were talking about how it used to be the Democrats. It used to be easy. You used to be able to tell by the uniforms, you know, Democrat, Republican. Now Republicans can be just as bad as Democrats. Politicians want you dumb and dependent. And whether it's, like Dad used to call it, General Electric, corporate welfare, whether they're giving you $200 a month or $2 billion a year, it doesn't matter. If the government keeps you dependent on them by giving you money, they got you, man. You're not going to mess that up. I'm not going to mess up my health care by getting a job. How many guys used to tell me that? When we first started this church, I was spiritual. I used to come and I used to pray for you guys. I didn't know you. I used to sit over there in that corner and I used to pray for you guys. And then I'd sit over there in this corner by myself in the dark and I'd pray for you guys. I didn't know who you were. I'd pray that God would use us to reach people for Jesus, help them become more like Jesus. And then people started coming to church and I used to pray for jobs. I used to pray that God would rain down jobs on this church. God, it was tough. As soon as we bought this building, the bottom dropped out of the economy. Our payments on this building were $7,500 a month and then utilities. That's what Lauren and I took on because we wanted to see people come to Jesus. As soon as we took this on, the bottom dropped out. Where are we going to get $7,500 a month plus utilities? I'd pray for that, and I would pray that God would rain down jobs on this church. Oh, God, these guys need work. These guys need jobs. And then I found out that a lot of the guys who were hanging around who didn't have jobs, they didn't want a job. They were getting unemployment. And they were getting medical coverage. I don't begrudge government help. I took it for a while, and I got off as soon as I could. I'm paying through the nose again. We're all paying. You all paid into it. There's a place for it. A lot of these guys didn't want jobs. And I used to joke, a lot of these guys, they want to graduate from unemployment to disability. I found out that a lot of those guys really did. They were really trying to figure out ways to work the system so they could get off of unemployment because, see, that's so hard. I could lose my unemployment. I want to get on disability, make more money, and it's more secure. These guys had messed up hands, they had messed up legs, messed up backs, but they could use those wrists and backs and legs for all the other stuff they wanted to do. I almost called them in myself. Hello, is this Unemployment Commission of New Mexico? I didn't. And I quit praying that God would rain down jobs on this church because a lot of those guys, they couldn't care less. Well, they left because I kicked them out. No, I didn't kick them out. But I'm not very compassionate. I appreciate you guys who understand this. Sometimes you have to work a job and two jobs. Sometimes some of you guys have worked three jobs. When I was in Bible college, when I was in school, I was working two jobs and going to school full time. There was a time I was going to Bible college full time. I was taking college courses in the junior college, and I had two jobs all at the same time. And you're trying to, take care of the real world stuff. I appreciate you guys who understand what it is to work hard. What I'm saying is this. Vote however you're going to vote. You ought to vote. You ought to vote. It's part of being a citizen. It's part of giving to Caesar what he deserves and giving God what he deserves. I used to say vote for the one that doesn't look like Santa Claus. Vote for the one that looks more like Jesus. No politician looks like Jesus anymore. But look at which one. How do they stand on Bible truth? How do they stand on abortion? The gun rights, that's not a big deal to me. The Bible doesn't say thou shalt carry or thou shalt not. Where it's a big deal to me is where they want to keep you so dependent that you cannot defend yourself against a crazy radical government or a crazy neighbor or a drug-fueled demon-possessed, heaven only knows what, trying to break into your house. You ought to be able to defend yourself. At some point, Jesus said, Peter, put the sword away, man. You live by the sword, you're going to die by the sword. At some point, you just trust Jesus with it. At some point, you just do. The Apostle Paul, at some point, you just trust Jesus with it. Yeah, I'm going to fight to the death. No, sometimes you just trust Jesus with it. I get that. But people who want to keep you dependent, that's a problem. Does that make sense? People who think it's okay for guys to go into girls' bathrooms or high school boys to go into girls' locker rooms because today they identify as, that's a problem. I mean, I don't know. Shoot, I don't know what's going on in, I don't know what's going on in my heart. I sure don't know what's going on in your heart. I just know that the Bible says that God made them, male and female, created he them. That is all I know. I don't know about the others. I don't know what's going on in people's lives. I'm just telling you that for someone who says, I'm trying to stand close to what God has to say, you can tell how they vote. But most people vote according to what the world wants, because like one sorry lying snake of a politician who came in here, Democrat, and got me to vote for him, only Democrat I ever voted for except for Jimmy Carter, because I didn't know better. He came in here and told me, listen, you can't get elected dog catchers a Republican in New Mexico. But once I get in office, I'm a conservative too. I'm going to stand for those things. And that lying dog, he got up there and he's doing everything he can to undermine everything biblical. Sorry, guy. Just had a matanza down here. Snake, a liar. Just a liar. Say anything to get into office. Anything. I'm going to stand on biblical proof. No, he's not. He's for everything that God says don't do. Again, you vote however you want. I'm just telling you that when you stand before the Lord, even this is going to come up. Practically everything that goes on in the world, you know, like wanting your own way, or wanting everything for yourself, or wanting to appear important, has nothing to do with the Father. It just isolates you from Him. That's another way of saying, don't be like the world. 1 John 2:16 in the New Living Translation, for the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure and a craving for everything that we see and pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from the Father, but these are from the world. That's what it is to be worldly. 1 John 2:15, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. Again, we're talking about this culture that tells us what's okay and what's not okay. Does that make sense? I'm trying to give you good, clear, accurate indicators. I don't care what you do. I was going to say, I'm not going to answer for you, but I am. I really am. I will answer. The Bible says, I as a pastor, for whatever reason you tripped over us, and you like coming here right now, maybe next week you won't, but right now you do. For right now, I'm teaching you, you can follow what I'm teaching, you can obey those who have rule over you, and I will be able to give an account for your life with joy. The converse is you can hear what I'm teaching, and you can decide to go your own way, not what I'm teaching, and I still will give an account for your soul. I just won't be able to do it with joy. Tony, didn't you tell him? Yeah. Didn't you try over and over and over to tell him? Yeah. I can't make him do. Can't even make him come, let alone, you know, obey my commands. You know? Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. 2 Peter 2:20. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but then again are tangled up in the world and are overcome, they're going to be worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. Man, don't get caught up in the world. 2 Peter 1:4, through these he has given us his very great and precious promises so that through them you may participate in the divine nature. That's coming to Christ, now becoming more like Christ. As you become more like Christ, you're participating in the divine nature. Doesn't mean you become a god. You become a little god. Doesn't mean that. I know it in my nowhere guy. Who's that guy? Andy of Mayberry, preacher-looking guy. With all the airplanes and the jets. Oh, my goodness. I can't think of his name. His wife preaches, too. They live in Oklahoma. Oh, my goodness. You guys are so spiritual, you don't even remember these guys. Well, he teaches this. Joyce Myers teaches this. Fred Price used to teach this. All the guys I used to like to watch, that you are little gods. You are not a little god. You're not. When it comes to me, I'll jump up and I'll say, I know who it is. He looks like Andy of Mayberry, that guy. I know it, my knower. Anyway, where am I? 2 Peter 1:4, 4:4, having escaped the corruption of the world, caused by evil desires. Then Ephesians 2, there are a lot of passages here. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world. and the ruler of the kingdom of this air, the spirit which is now still at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time. We were gratifying the desires of our own flesh, following our cravings and thoughts, and like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. We don't want to be there. We don't want to be like the world. Galatians 6:14, may I never boast except in the cross of Christ Jesus, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Paul was able to say, I don't want to be like them anymore. I don't want to be like everybody around me anymore. I love them. I just don't want to be like them. You've got family that you love and neighbors and friends, and you know, you don't hate them. But as you become more like Jesus, you shouldn't want to be like them. You want to be with them. Let them come into your world as you follow Jesus. Don't let them drag you into their world as they don't follow Jesus. I'm crucified to this world. What's next? I'm lost on my notes. My notes look like your notes, except they're all mushed together. 2 Timothy 4:9. Do your best to come to me quickly, Timothy, because Demas, my partner, my buddy, my co-worker, Demas, because he loved this present world, has deserted me, and he's gone to Thessalonica. The Apostle Paul had a partner, a co-preacher working with him, and he left the ministry because he loved this world. So what is the world? Well, serving and sacrificing for the Lord. What is the world? Well, it's whatever this culture is, but anything that keeps you from seeking the Lord, that's the world. Anything that keeps you from serving the Lord, that's the world. Anything that keeps you from sacrificing for the Lord. When you come in, I suggested last week, suggested, I went like that, but you didn't obey. So I'll just say I suggested. For an envelope, grab a blue book. Get a program, because if you don't, Eddie's going to follow you home and get one in your hand. So you might as well take the program. Two, take an offering envelope so that you can give. Give. And don't just give all secret. Take an offering envelope. Put your name on it so I can see how you're giving. None of your business. Well, see, yeah, it's my business. That's what I'm here for. Give, give. If you're not tithing, give more. I don't think tithing is a New Testament principle. I think it's a good place to start. I think if you can go out to eat, you can give at least that much to the church. Well, if I got as good of meals at the church as I got over there at McDonald's, I would give $2 or whatever. Anything that keeps you from giving to the Lord, that's the world. Anything that keeps you from serving the Lord, that takes your time so that you can't try to reach people for Jesus through Southwest Church, because this is where you are, that's the world. I'm not saying you're dirty dog, evil, sinful, wicked, going to hell. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that now that you're a saint, now that you're a Christian, now that you've come to the Lord, if you want to live for the Lord, I want to give you good indicators. I want to give you an indicator that tells you if you're doing okay or not doing okay. And I'm telling you, anything that keeps you from giving or doing or saying no to yourself for the Lord, that's the world. That's what it is. He works to seduce you so that you won't serve God. He wants you to be worldly. If you love anything in this life more than you love the Lord, you're probably not saved. And if you're thinking, you ready? If you're thinking that this life is for your happiness, and that giving God a little here and a little there, even if you think it's a lot here and a lot there, if you're thinking this life is for your happiness and that giving God a little bit here and a little bit there is enough, Kenneth Copeland, that one. He says you're a little God. You are so not a little God. Psh. And giving God a little bit here and giving God a little bit there is enough, you're probably not serving the Lord. I'm talking to saints now. You may be doing for the Lord. I'm not saying you're not doing for the Lord. I'm saying that God makes a distinction between doing things for God and serving God. He makes a distinction between serving the way we think, serving and serving. Romans 12, verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourselves a living sacrifice. You know what they did with sacrifices? It was a matanza, except for the Lord. They took it, they hung the lamb upside down, they cut the neck, cut the throat, catch the blood, offer the blood as a sacrifice. I'm begging you, brothers and sisters, Paul says, present yourself a sacrifice to the Lord, a living sacrifice, not to die, like die at French Daniel's funeral home, not that kind of die. Die to yourself so that you're not giving you everything you want. Serve him so that you're giving him everything he wants. So if your prayers are more help me, gimme, gimme, I'm not saying you're a dirty, rotten dog going to hell. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that I want your indicators to be, yeah? How am I doing? Let me help you. If you're thinking that this life is for your happiness and that giving God a little here or a lot there and a little here or a lot there, if you think that's enough, you're not serving the Lord. You may be doing for the Lord, but you're not serving the Lord. And guess what he wants us to do? Serve the Lord with zeal, with excitement, with joy, because he saved us that we might serve. If he didn't want you to serve, he'd have killed you after you got saved. Why leave you around to mess up your life? He'd have saved you, taken you home while you were still perfect. Right then, you were sinless. Right then, Jesus saved me. Boop, you're sinless. And then, ooh, you messed it up right after that. Because that's the way we are. But he didn't kill you as soon as he saved you. He killed you and he left you. Oh, he killed you and he left you. He saved you and he left you. You're supposed to kill you. You're supposed to die to self. So, for sinners, he tries to keep them from salvation. For saints, he tries to keep us from service. How does he do that? Well, he makes us worldly. He tries to make us worldly. And then two, he not only tries to seduce us so that we won't serve God, he tries to sidetrack us so that we won't serve the Lord, so that we become worthless. Hold on to your seatbelts. Here we go. Hold on to your seatbelts. You're still gonna die. Hold on to your seat. Buckle in. That's the one I want. 1 Corinthians 9:19. Though I am free and I belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. Paul didn't have to serve the Lord, but he chose to. Could have done anything he wanted. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law. Why? So that I could win those under the law, to win Jews. 21. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law. That's not an antinomian. It's not a criminal who doesn't follow the law. This is a person, a Greek. This is a Gentile, not a Jew. I tried to reach them for the Lord, not like trying to be a super Jew. I did it by understanding where they were coming from. I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. 22, to the weak, I'm trying to help you see what it means to be sidetracked so that your life becomes worthless. Again, that's a word that God uses. Because saint, believer, Christian, when you stand before the Lord, your works, every good thing you've done, every good thing you're doing, every good thing. You know, you let the viejitos get in front of you in line at Albertson. Thank you so much because I'm old now. That's a good thing. You drive slower so that you're safer for everybody around you. You say thank you, no thank you. You're polite. You know they give you the wrong change at McDonald's. You give them the right change. And every good thing you're doing, you come to church. You give in the offering. You come. You know we sing a song or we preach a sermon or we clean up or we whatever. Every good thing you're doing is going to stand before the Lord in judgment. Everything done in service, good and gold and silver, will be tried and will come out better. You'll be rewarded for that. Everything else good that you've done, I'm not talking about bad, everything else good that you've done that is not done in service for the Lord is going to burn up, wood, hay, and stubble. God says you'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ so that your works will be judged whether good or bad. And the Greek words translated good or bad are worthwhile or worthless. That's all I'm talking about when I say that Satan tries to sidetrack us so that the good things we're doing are pointless. They might make you happy, but they're not making him happy. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I become all things to all people that by all possible means I might save some. Guess what he wants you to be doing so that you won't be worthless? Try to reach people for Jesus. I do all this for the sake of the gospel. The rest of 23, that I may share in the blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone competes in the games and goes into strict training. Man, I watch some of you guys discipline yourselves for work, for different things. I watch Josh discipline himself for competition, and I think he's just crazy. I wouldn't do that. He does it to win a competition. To win the competition, you have to practice. Joe practices. I watch Lauren practice. I watch the guys practice. They're practicing because they want to honor God, and they want to do you justice. And so they practice. That's what Paul's talking about here. Everyone competes in the games, goes into strict training. If you're going to serve the Lord, you have to train. That's why this is important. That's why Wednesday night is important. That's why hanging out around here. Come early and stay late so you can see things that need to be done. I don't want to give you a job description. I just want you to love us, and you see what happens around here, and you jump in and try to help. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that's not going to last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I'm not fighting like a boxer beating the air. I'm not shadow boxing, he says. I'm actually in, competing, 27. So I strike a blow to myself. I beat my body. Not physically like the penitentes? Is it the ones with the whips? Not like that. Not like that. But he disciplines himself. He makes his body hurt. Not so much the physical body, but sometimes the physical body. I make the real person on the inside hurt. I tell me no. I strike a blow to my body. I make it my slave so that after I preach to others, I myself will not become disqualified for the prize. This is the Apostle Paul saying, oh God, please don't let me stand before you and hear you say everything you did was worthless. This is the Apostle Paul. If he's in that position, how much more are we? Oh God, please don't let me waste my life. Paul did good things. Paul did godly things. Paul was doing things for the Lord. He was concerned, Lord, am I actually serving you? Having done all of these good things for you, oh God, please don't let me be disqualified for the prize. For we will all stand before the judgment seat, as it is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will acknowledge God. So then each of us will give an account of ourselves to God. That's you, saint. That's you, believer. That's you, Christian. Every one of you will stand before the Lord and will give an account for your life. Not to determine whether you get to stay in heaven or not. If you're there, you're in. But reward is something that he talks about. Not like, I want a reward. Not like that. I don't understand it. I'm just saying it's important to God. It should be important to us. You will stand before God and you will give an account to God. 2 Corinthians 5:9. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body, alive, or away from it, dead. For we must all appear, verse 10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each of us may receive what is done or what is due us for the things done while in the body, for how you lived your life while you were alive, whether good or bad. And that good or bad, that's the worthwhile or worthless. Since then, we know what it is to be afraid of God. We try to get others saved. Since we know what it is to stand before a fearful God, we try to convince others to serve. That's what I'm doing. I'm not doing it well, but that's what I'm doing. So if your activities are, you can, as soon as you're out of here, you're going to forget half of this stuff. But some of it might stick, and when it does, don't get all scared. If you find some of it sticking, use this to reevaluate your indicators. As you're evaluating, how am I doing? Is this okay? How am I doing? How am I living my life? Hey, am I doing okay? Hey, am I doing okay? As you're trying to decide whether you're good or bad, this is what I want you to hang on to. I believe this is biblical. If I didn't, I wouldn't put it up here. Or I would say, here comes the Tonyism. No, I think this is the truth. If your activities, everything you're doing, I'm not saying you have to preach in church all day long. I'm saying any place, anything, pumping gas, buying groceries, helping an old guy across the street, anything you're doing, any good thing, any bad thing, anything, everything you do, brushing your teeth, helping grandkids tie their shoes, everything. I don't know how. I'm just telling you. If your activities aren't directly tied to winning souls for the Lord, they are wasted activities. I'm just telling you. That's what it looks like. They're not bad. They're just going to burn up. They're wood, hay, and stubble. I mean, there's some things you should do. You know, I don't know if you use axe or right guard or... That's probably not a bad thing. Or maybe you just walk around smelling like a, you know, caveman. Hey, Lauren likes it when I smell like Sasquatch, yeah. It's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. I'm just not going to be rewarded before the Lord for it. She'll get rewarded for loving me anyway, but yeah. You know, she does a good thing, and, you know, she makes my tacos. Or, bless her heart, she found out one time I like pecan pie. She figured out how to make pecan pies. Then I told her, I don't even like all that syrupy, sticky stuff. I just like the pecan stuff. Yeah. She made me a pecan pie that was, it was so dry and thick. Yeah. It was perfect, just what I wanted. Because she loves me. I don't know that she's going to get rewarded before the Lord, you know, a crown for that. I'm telling you, I love it. But what I'm doing when I'm brushing my teeth and what she's doing when she's making me pecan pie or tacos or, you know, going to Modelo's and bringing me tamales or whatever, whatever we're doing, I'm here, blah, 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 and you're here and you're, oh, okay, amen, 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 you know. Everything that you do, if somehow this is tied together, if somehow this is tied together so that somebody that you're tied together with reaches somebody for Jesus, because one sows, one waters, and God brings the increase. I know some of you guys, man, you're trying hard. You're inviting people to come. They won't come. I know. I know when you come and you... I mean, it's a big deal for you to carve out time to come here. I get it. This culture has already warped us. It has. And it's hard for a lot of you guys to come, and I, you know, I make it sound like I don't appreciate it, and I really do. I'm just telling you that when you stand before the Lord, all the good things you've done, they're going to burn up. They're just, you know, they're going to be worthless. The only thing that's going to last is whatever you've done to reach people for Jesus and then to help them become more like Jesus. Lauren and I started this to help you do that. We didn't start this so we could do it. We started this to help you do this. If the TVs help, good. If the music helps, good. If the... on the screens help, good. If the good looking pictures on the front of the program help, good. If they don't, it's worthless. None of this matters. We're doing all of this to help you reach people for Jesus and help them become more like Jesus, because that's all that's going to matter when you stand before the Lord. And I ain't all that. This is an easy way for me to do this. I'm not going to go knock on some stranger's door. Hey, can I talk to you about Jesus? What do you think? You know, I don't want to do that. I like doing it this way. But I want you to reach people for Jesus. I don't know, inviting them to come to the church here, and they say, I don't know, maybe it's time to start another service. I don't know. Maybe it's time to start a 9 o'clock in the morning, no song, no sermon service, where it's just Q&A, just question and answers. People ask questions, and we give them Bible answers. I don't know. Maybe it's time to start another church downtown somewhere. Maybe it's time to start another service on Saturday night that's just simple gospel Jesus stories. Not a bunch of sermons. We just go through the gospel. I don't know. There's nothing magic about being in a building. I'm telling you that. The name of the game is not get people in a church. The name of the people is get people into Christ. But in our culture, this is acceptable. But if it's worthless, then I'm wasting your time. So everything I'm telling you with the understanding that I'm going to give an account to. If your activities aren't directly tied to winning souls for the Lord, they're wasted activities. If your life isn't dedicated to winning souls for the Lord, you're wasting your life. How mean am I? I'm trying to help you get clear, accurate indicators, because this is how I'm giving you all the answers to the quiz when you stand before the Lord. This is what he's going to look for. This is how he's going to evaluate your life. I'm just helping you. If your life isn't dedicated, and most people don't want that. Okay, all right, I'm just telling you, you're going to fail. That's all. Believer, you'll still be in heaven. Unbelievers, forget service, man. They just need to get saved. But if life isn't dedicated to winning souls for the Lord, you're wasting your life. And Satan wants to sidetrack you so that you won't serve God. He wants you to be worthless. He wants you to waste your life. He doesn't care if you're doing good. Just don't be reaching people for God. He hates that. Satan is dangerous. For the sinner, Satan tries to hinder salvation. For the saint, Satan tries to hinder service. He works to seduce you so that you won't serve God. He wants you to be worldly. He works to sidetrack you so that you won't serve God. He wants you to become worthless. My job is to get you in the game and living for God. My job is to get you saved, soaked, and serious. That's my job. My job is to help you come to the Lord. My job is to help you live for the Lord. For reals. Not for a while. Not for fake. Not for show. For reals. My job is to help you really get born again, saved. And if you really get born again, saved, you're going to want to be obedient. And the first obvious step of obedience is to get baptized. I want to help you get saved. I want to help you get soaked. And then I want to help you get serious. Saved, soaked, and serious. Where do we get that from? Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Saved. Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Make disciples of all nations. Two, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That's soaked. And then teach them. I can't do that. And then teach them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. Teach them to do everything I've taught you to do. That's where we get saved, soaked, and serious. I want you to admit. This is what the kids are learning in there. Right now they're playing because I've gone long, but they're learning to do the ABCs of salvation. Admit that you're a sinner. Believe that Jesus is God and he's the only way to heaven, and commit your life to the Lord. If you can do that on your own and reach souls for Jesus, knock them out, man. Knock it out of the park. Go do it for the Lord. But if somehow we can help you do that, get in deeper, give more, come more, serve more, so that together we could partner up and reach more people for Jesus. Does that make sense? All right. Let me know if there's anything I can do to help you along those lines. Let's pray. God, thank you for these guys. Thank you for their time. Thank you for the time they carved out to come here to meet with you today. God, I pray that you would lift the burdens that they're under. God, I realize that those very burdens, those very difficulties are tools that you are using to shape us and to steer us to live good and godly lives. But Lord, I pray that there would be some relief, some joy in all of the hurt, in all of the sorrow, in all of the pain represented here this morning. God, when it's all said and done, I pray that every one of us would be able to stand before you and hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Good job. You started off kind of slow, kind of rocky, but you pulled it off. Good job." I pray that every one of us here would be able to hear that. God, help us live our lives for you. Somehow, help us reach more people for you. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving us first. Help us live for you. In your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. God bless you guys.